he was concerned with. And all of a sudden there was a light that shone from heaven. Paul, Paul, or Saul, why are you persecuting me? It's hard for you to kick against the pricks. And God got his attention. That's the way it is with every sinner. None of us were looking for God. None of us. If you don't believe me, read Romans 1 and find out what Paul said about the heart of man in Romans 1. There's none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They're altogether gone out of the way. They've turned every man to their own way. All of that the Bible describes an unsaved man, an unsaved woman. That was you or me. And then he says in Ephesians 2, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. You bring a casket in here, and there's a man or a woman laying in it, and they're dead. I can yell at them. I can kick them, scream, yell. I could take a pen and pinch them. They are not going to respond. They're not going to respond. That's the way you were, and that's the way I were when we were lost. We were dead in trespasses and sins. And God made the first move. There's Lazarus laying in a tomb. And Jesus says, Lazarus, come forth. Only the Son of God could do that. Only the Son of God could do that. And that's what he did for you and for me when he spoke to us and we came to life through his marvelous grace. Now, why did he do that? Why did he take us out of darkness and put us into light? So that we would do what? That we would be his love gift, that we would be his love gift from the Father to us. And then he wants us to minister to one another. And these people at Rome, he was very interested in, the ones at Corinth, very interested in. And look at verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Have you ever done that? Have you ever completely presented your body unto him as a living sacrifice? That's what he says here, completely. That's the first step now. You'll never find a spiritual gift. You'll never know a spiritual gift until you present your body to him completely as a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly as he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, we are one body in Christ, and every one members of one another. Now notice the analogy there. One body, many members. The body of Christ is one, but it has many members. We are members one of another. Does that mean then that I'm going to affect you in some way? What it means, doesn't it? I'm going to affect you in some way. I hope that we affect one another in a positive way. Now, we can affect one another in a negative way. We are members one of another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy, according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministry, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth with diligence. He that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without hypocrisy or dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. I like this now. Be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love, in honor preferring one another. Now, I'm pausing and saying some things, but they're very important to me and should be very important to us. How is the best way for us to minister to one another? Well, I'm just going to let you know how I feel about you. I really don't like you. I don't like the way you look. I don't like your personality. Boy, that wins friends and influence people, doesn't it? But you know, sad to say, in so many churches, we're not kindly affectionate one another in many churches. Now, we're talking about spiritual gifts and how we can use spiritual gifts to minister to one another. And there's so many churches that say they have the gifts and all they do is fuss and fight. And they're not kindly affectionate one to another. Not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer, distributing to the necessity of the saints, given to hospitality. Bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend, that is, come down to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceit. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be as possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto the wrath, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if an enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink, for in so doing thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Now look quickly in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Now concerning spiritual graces or spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as you were led. Wherefore I give you understanding that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is Lord but by the Holy Spirit. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are diversities of administrations, but the same Lord. There are diversities of operation, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another the interpretation of tongues. But these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. For as the body is one and hath many members, and all members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink of that one Spirit. For the body is not one member but many. Let's stand now and let's pray together and ask the Lord to bless us in our time this evening. A year from now or 2 years from now, I would just love for us to look at this church and see a tremendous difference in all of our lives, because we found out from the Scriptures through the Holy Spirit, this is my gift. This is my gifts, plural. I know what they are. I know what they mean. I know how God will use them. I can spot it in others, and so I can help others discover their gifts. Now, you may have serving gifts, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. You may have serving gifts, but you may also have speaking gifts. You may also have sign gifts. Now, we'll get to that a little bit later on. Now, keep in mind that there are temporary gifts that faded away with the apostles. We'll look at those. Then there are permanent gifts that will stay with us until the end of the church age, until we all come into the unity of the faith and we're in heaven with the Lord. Now let's look tonight, first of all, at the serving gifts. The serving gifts. Now let me say this about the serving gifts. If you have them, listen very carefully, and I hope that you'll understand. They are the most overlooked of all the gifts, the most overlooked. Usually when someone in the church looks at the serving gifts and sees what they are, they may say, I'm not sure about that. But don't overlook the fact that if you have this gift, that God can mightily use you. They're usually the most least appreciated of all of the gifts. But you know what I've learned down through the years as a pastor? I want people in my church to have all of these gifts, all of them. I've discovered down through the years that the people that have these gifts are the ones that are just sort of the least noticed. They labor in the background. They don't ask for a lot. They're not high maintenance. They're not seen. They don't need their name in the bulletin. They don't need to be recognized. They'd just rather blend in the background, but they do a tremendous, tremendous job. Tremendous job. At Buffalo Baptist Church, I was there for almost 9 years, and been there all of that time, and I taught on gifts and so forth. And we had men and women in our church that sat out there, and if you didn't see them or walk up to them, they were just there. But I knew what they did. I knew what they did. I knew how they reached out to people in the church. And they would reach out to people no one else reached out to. Let me just give you an example. The first of the month, the first Wednesday of the month, we had what we call family night. We didn't meet in the auditorium. We met in the fellowship hall, and we had family night. And everybody brought a plate, a different kind of a plate, and you'd have a list of what you were to bring for family night. We'd meet in the auditorium, and we would eat together and fellowship together. The men would break up in a group. The ladies would break up in a group. The teens would break up in a group. The children would break up in a group. And we would have a great time together. We men had a great time. We called ourselves the Brotherhood. And the Brotherhood was responsible for the taking care of the grounds. That was their responsibility. They were to constantly be looking at the auditorium, the fellowship hall. They were to look at the grounds, and they were to have a list of things that needed to be done, and they got them done. It might be one man coming in one day and two or three men another day, but that's what they did. And we studied the scriptures together, and the ladies studied missions together, and so forth and so on. But a lot of those times we would have guests to come in. Now, sad to say, and this happens sometimes in, I guess, every churches, but sometimes these people might not look like, hey, that's not our group. They don't fit with us. Poor, shabbily dressed, maybe. See where I'm going? This would happen on homecomings, on fellowships. We'd have a lot of different things through the year. We'd have car shows. That kind of thing. And people would come. Well, here's what I would notice, the people that had serving gifts. I'm looking around, and of course, as pastor, I shake hands with everybody. I go around and shake hands with everybody. Sue does the same, did the same thing. And I'd look over there, and there'd be this family sitting there by themselves. Well, guess who were the ones that got up, walked over to them and said, "Hi, I am. I'm so glad that you are here. Is there anything that I can do for you? Can I help you?" And then they would go visit them. And they would find out what their needs were, and they would minister to their needs. Sad to say, there were some, and you'll have this in most churches, there were some that just wouldn't say hi because they didn't want to be around them. Isn't that sad? But the people that have the serving gifts, they look for these kind of people. They look for the kind of people that they can reach out to and that they can help. They have, it's almost like they have feelers that reaches out to people in need. God gives them that gift. They can just see a person in need. They have a need. And God's given them the gift to go to those people and fill that need. Now, they don't want nobody to praise them. They don't want the pastor to say, he did so-and-so, she did so-and-so. I don't know how many times I've had men in my church that would walk up to me and he would say, "Preacher, you see that family over there? See that man over there? See that woman over there?" "Yes." And he'd hand me an envelope and he'd say, "I want you to give that envelope to those people. Now, I have a policy that I don't like to handle church money. I'd just rather not handle church money in any way, form, or fashion. Now, I want to know everything that's going on. I want to know how much is how much and how much is not, and I want to know it all. But I don't want to touch the money. I don't want anybody to say, well, the preacher misappropriated. I don't want that. So I would try to say to him, give it to one of the deacons. No, I want you to, Pastor. And I said, well, you stand right here and watch me. And I'd go back to that couple or I'd go back to that individual and I would say, Brother so-and-so wants you to have this. Or I might say to them, an anonymous member who doesn't want to be known wants you to have this. That's a person that has these gifts of serving gifts. I don't know how many times that I've watched that and I've just sat back and my heart just glowed because I saw these people. Now, thank God for the other people that have the speaking gifts. Thank God for them. They don't care to get up in front of people. They don't care to lead. You need those folk. But we need these that have these serving gifts. And maybe the least appreciated among all of the church family because they're just not really up front and so forth. And so they're referred to as those that serve. Now, these people that serve, God uses them to build up the church just as much as those that have the showy gifts, the outward gifts, the gifts that gets the applause, the gifts that get someone to come to them and say, boy, I really enjoyed that lesson. I really enjoyed that song, whatever it may be. And so ask the Lord, what is your gift? Well, is your gift a serving gift? Well, let me remind you that it might be you might be the least appreciated person in the church. You may not get the applause. You may get people coming up to you and patting you on the back. But you know what these people do? As they serve the church, God uses them to build up the church and to protect the church and to broaden the church's ministry. And you just never know what God may do through the ministry of these people. Now go over to 1 Peter 4 and look at verse 11. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 11. I'll take my time while Betty rumbles through the pages of her Bible, giving her plenty of time to go to the New Testament. You got it. All right. You're a prize. You know that, don't you? All right. Look at verse 11. Well, actually, let's back up to verse 9 here. Actually, let's back up to verse 8. And above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves. For charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Use hospitality one to another without grudging. As every man hath received the gift, even so to minister the same one to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If any man speak, let him speak as of the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Grace gifts to minister to other people. Now, leadership, government, hospitality, full discernment, we want to have all of these things in our church, but we need these gifts. Now, we must identify with our gift. So if you're not sure what your gift or gifts are, when you go home tonight, get alone with the Lord, get on your knees, get in a private place, say, Lord, is my gift giving gifts? Is this what you want me to do? Let me identify my gifts. Let the Holy Spirit remind me what my gifts are so that I will be able to use this gift to minister to others. Now, did you see how Peter worded this? He's talking here about the matter of wisdom and the Spirit and the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge by the same Spirit and how he meshes all of these together. And then verse 10, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues. All of these can be meshed together for the building up of the church, even though these gifts we're talking about may be the less attractive or maybe the ones that's less sought after. But don't be the kind of a person that desires a gift, but that's not your gift. Make sure that the Lord is leading in these things. Now, the same token, don't be jealous. If you have these gifts, if you have serving gifts, don't be jealous of those that have the showy gifts. And I use that term, showy, so you'll understand what I'm talking about. There are some that have gifts and they're always in front of the people. Always in front of the people. They're always seen. They're always heard. They always get praises heaped upon them. If they really, you know, if they're given these gifts and they're talented, they can use these gifts to really minister to a lot of people through song. Can you imagine the millions of people that were touched by George Beverly Shea? Can you imagine that? I mean, God gave that man a gift. You don't know who George Beverly Shea is? Tell what you do. You want to be blessed, Bethany? You know what YouTube is? You don't? Kevin, do you know what YouTube gift is? Sure, okay. Go on there and type in the Billy Graham Crusade. Listen to George Beverly Shea sing. Okay, you will be blessed. He ministered to people through singing. And he was, what, 89, something like that when he passed away, still singing? More than that? We had a man in our church that met him over in North Carolina and went over and bought him and his wife and was sitting there and they bought his lunch. And he was just so gracious, he said. And this man said, well, he's exactly what you would think that he would be. Gracious and kind and just, you know, uplifting. And Billy Graham said that George Beverly Shea didn't perform, he ministered. And he ministered through song. Thousands heard him sing. And that's a wonderful thing. But wait a minute. If you have the gifts that we're talking about here, if you possess them, they are just as important to the body of Christ than the man that sings to thousands. Or the quartet that sings to thousands, or the groups that sings to thousands. And then here's something else. Don't criticize those people. Don't criticize them. Because God gave them that gift for a reason. He gave them that gift to minister to the church. I so thank God that the first two pastors that I had, the first two that I had the gift of pastor-teacher. Both of them did. But they had also the gift of serving too. They preached to the people, they taught the people, but they served. And they served other people. And boy, the Lord used them to touch my heart from the time I was just a kid. And then all right on up through, and then Wayne Williams came along and just brought men in my life. Don't criticize those that have the showy gifts, if you want to say that, the public gifts, whatever they may be. And now we know that there's 19 gifts in all, and there are 7 gifts of helps, 7 of them. And we're going to go through them during the course of our study. Here's the way we're going to do it as we study the gifts. First of all, we're going to look at the meaning of the gift. What do they mean to the church? We're going to look at the model of the gift. We're going to look in the Scripture at men or women that modeled that gift. We're going to look at the manifestation of the gift, how the Lord manifested that gift to the people and manifested it to other people. And that's a very, very important thing. But then we're going to look at the menace of the gift. If we're not careful and we use it the wrong way, it can become a menace. And I've seen that happen in the church. I've seen it hurt the church. We're going to look then at the modern example of that gift. And hopefully as we look at all of these gifts and we look at it from that vernacular, we'll be able to understand the gift and how it works, how to search for it, how to look for it, and all of those things. Now look at 1 Corinthians 12:28. 1 Corinthians 12:28. And God has set some in the church. First apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gift of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. Underscore the word helps. If you're here tonight and you have that gift, ask God to show you that that is your gift. Now look at Romans 12:7. Romans 12 and verse 7. On ministry, let him wait on our ministry, or he that teacheth on teaching. And so ministry would come under that heading. Helps, ministry, so forth. Service, helps. And then, of course, we already looked at the verses in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 9 through 11. Now, these people help the sick. They help the poor. They help the needy. They're people that just reach out. A deacon can have this gift because a deacon, the word deacon means servant. None of our deacons are here tonight, but did you know that the word deacon actually means in the Greek, listen for it, one who waits on tables. That's what it means. Table waiters. Now let's go back to the book of Acts. Now I'm not, no, don't turn there. Billy's about to turn there. He's sitting by Betty. That's the reason. We said this last week. What happened in the book of Acts? The church grew so much. The church in Acts grew so much. You, by the way, you read the book of Acts and see how many times it says the Lord added to the church. I'm going to bring a message one Sunday morning on how the Lord adds to the church. There are certain things we have to do for him to add to the church. God adds when we, and I'm going to mention four or five things, God adds to the church. And if we'll do those things, one of them is prayer. God will add to the church when you pray and so forth. And we want the Lord to add to the church. But there has to be people, as the Lord adds to the church, to minister to them. So, there's a group of widows that had been neglected in the administration. The church was already ministering to the poor. They had already sold possessions, gave it to the church, gave it to the apostles, so there would be no gathering, so that there would be nobody starving, there would be nobody hungry. And so they were already giving, they were already sacrificing. And then the apostles couldn't minister to everybody. And so this group of widows were unministered to. And so the Holy Spirit said, look you out seven men of honest report that they can give themselves to this work, and we will give ourselves to the ministry of prayer and the ministry of the word. Now, did you hear that? That's what Acts 2 says. Acts 1 and 2, that's what it says. What does the pastor to do? He's to give himself to prayer and the ministry of the word. Prayer and the ministry of the word. Do you want a pastor to preach with power? Do you want him to preach with wisdom? Do you want him to love the church? And do you want him to minister to the church? And listen now. How does he come to that point? Spending time in prayer with God and study. Now, I believe that the Lord will give him that time if the rest of the church discovers their gift and gifts and they're doing it. Watch now. The pastor gives himself to prayer, the ministry of the word. The Lord says, look you out deacons. So we pray about deacons. And we're praying right now about adding deacons to our deacon board. Two of our men have been on there about three of them have been on there about 5 years, and they want to back away some, and so we need to add some men to the deacon board, and we need two or three, really. And we need some men so that as we minister, and our church is needs a lot of things done, there's a lot of things that has to be done, and somebody's got to do it, and we need some men that'll come together, and we can meet, and we can pray together, and we can say, now here's what we'll do. And then you administrate. This man, I know he can do this. This man, I know he can do that. This lady can do this. I know this lady can do that. And so the pastor, the deacons, goes to these people and says, you have this gift. You do this well. Will you do this? And so what happens? Here's the church, and we minister to everybody, and we get things done. Isn't that what should be done? And get things done. And take the gospel to the world. Pastor has to have faithful, solid deacons. And so you pray that the Lord will lay on our hearts the men that he wants us to serve. Now let me say this. And I know I'm chasing a little rabbit here, but I think he needs to be caught. He's run wild too long. Did you notice that in 1 Timothy 3, when the Bible gives the qualifications for a pastor and deacons, that it says something about the deacon's wife, but it doesn't say anything about the pastor's wife? Have you ever noticed that? Why do you think that is? Is it the pastor's wife's not important? No. The deacon's wife is to assist her husband in ministering to the church. As he ministers to the church, he finds that there are things he can't do in ministering to ladies, but his wife can. And so she can get ladies in the church to help her and minister to people in the church. Now, some churches call that a deaconess, and I really don't like that word, but basically what it is, it's a lady who ministers. So I don't have any problem with that. Amen? And by the way, there are ladies that are great Bible teachers. Great Bible teachers. And they're wonderful. My first pastor's wife, Brother Francis, was a much better speaker than him. Much better speaker than him. And she taught a Sunday school class of ladies. And boy, the ladies loved her. I mean, the auditorium was filled with ladies on Sunday morning. And some of the men started sneaking in. And you know what she said? Get out of here. Get out of here. Go to my husband's class. She said, God didn't call us to teach men. She just had a great spirit, and she called her husband's name. His last name was Francis, G.N. Francis, and she called him Francis. So you better not ever call me Boofer. Nah. But what am I saying? I'm saying she was greatly used of God. And the deacon's wife can be greatly used of God. So, what do? We find out what our gift or gifts are, and we minister. They are helps. They are service. They are ministry. So a deacon can have that gift. Other people in the church can have that gift. And the Lord wants those people to serve joyfully. Joyfully. And if they serve joyfully, just watch what God does. Now, what's the purpose? For the building up, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Now, we'll continue on with this next week. First of all, let's